the rest of you folks. I don't think that leaves anybody out. This is a real pleasure for me. First time in 46 years I found myself in this position, and that's to have a graduate who's graduating from high school. And there's a lot of things that go through your mind when you come to this particular part of your life. And Friday, there were just kids out of control on a campus. And today, they're grown-ups. And I'm excited for them. Scripture says, and this was a scripture that was given to me by the class. It's specifically 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 10, but I'd like to read the first 11 verses to you, if I may, please. And that's this. Therefore, since Christ suffered in his body, arm yourselves also with the same attitude, because he who has suffered in his body is done with sin. As a result, he does not live the rest of his earthly life for evil human desires, but rather for the will of God. For you have spent enough time in the past doing what pagans choose to do, living in debauchery, lust, drunkenness, orgies, carousing, and detestable idolatry. And they think it's strange that you do not plunge with them into the same flood of dissipation. And they heap abuse on you. But they will have to give account to him who is ready to judge the living and the dead. For this is the reason the gospel was preached even to those who are now dead, so that they might be judged according to men in regard to the body, but live according to God in regard to the spirit. The end of all things is near, therefore be clear-minded and self-controlled, so that you can pray. Above all, love each other deeply, because love covers over a multitude of sins. Offer hospitality to one another without grumbling. And here's the verse that they chose as kind of their class verse. Each one should use whatever gift he has received to serve others faithfully, administering God's grace in its various forms. If anyone speaks, he should do it as one speaking the very words of God. If anyone serves, he should do it with the strength God provides, so that in all things God may be praised through Jesus Christ. To him be the glory and the power forever and ever. Let's just call for a word of prayer, shall we, please? Heavenly Father, any time we have the opportunity to share some things from this living and written word, I sense there words of life. So, Father, I just pray that you give clarity, boldness, wisdom, understanding, and discernment from that word, that it might bring honor and glory to yourself, and send us unapologetically to a world that's in so much need of this tremendous gospel of Jesus Christ's death, burial, and resurrection. Thank you, Lord, for the privilege of this time, that we can pause momentarily as a graduating class, and moms and dads, relatives, and loved ones. Can just pause one final time as a group like this and sort of gather around your word and receive some sober and tremendous news from your word that will cause us never to be the same. And Lord, what a privilege it is, that being the case every time we open this tremendous. So do a work in us, we pray in Jesus' name, for his sake. Amen. Do any of you know what baccalaureate means? I looked it up, and it means like a bachelor's degree, or in this particular sense, it means a sermon to a graduating class. And that's what a baccalaureate service is all about. We have an opportunity to gather corporately as men and women, students, and to be able to consider some things, sort of as a family, just before the class breaks up once and for all after graduation. And we have an opportunity to be able to view from God's Word some things that are very, very important, maybe some final instruction that the Lord has for us on, to sort of send us on our way. And so as I looked at these different things, I just considered some thoughts very, very briefly, because I want to get to the last part of this and spend a little bit of time there. Verse 1, it says, arm yourselves with the heaviest armor as opposed to light armor. The Lord Jesus Christ is telling us here through the writer that don't wait to use your weapons until later. Don't wait or fight the beginning of the battle with your light infantry. But looking at this, the Greek kind of pushes the fact that come out into life with your best weapons right away. Verse 1 continues, don't be ashamed to be persecuted for right things, the writers say. Don't be ashamed to be persecuted for the right things. Stand up. Be men. Be women. And then it says further on in the same verse, work the gospel. The gospel's been given to us. His death, his burial, and his resurrection. Now work it. That's the weapon. That's the big gun. Work them. Verse 2, he's given us victory over stuff so that we might live. Verse 3, old things are passed away, all things have become new. The Lord received all of our sin. He's taken our total load. Put off the old man, put on the new. 1 Corinthians 10:14 says, keep away from, avoid, by flight if need. Stay away from any kind of idolatry. Verse 4, run. And I look this word run up. And it says this, an excess pouring forth which fill in the hollows. And then in Luke 15:13 it says, as far as the word riot there, like the prodigal son squandering his substance with wild living. The Bible says, stay away from that. Run from that. Verse 5, the lost will have to give an account to God, who is holding himself in readiness to judge the living and the dead. Students, we live our lives. You don't have to live life with your kind of your tail between your legs. Verse 6 basically tells us that. It says, heaven or hell are within, on an eternal scale, just moments for all men. You think of God as far as his eternity is concerned. Think of this. Time, as far as we're concerned, and then God, say for example, pausing for a second to sneeze, which he wouldn't do, all right? But just say for example, he does this. And then all of a sudden, he sneezes. Took but a moment at this time. That could have taken 20 years of our time. So you think of this. Life 70 or 70 years. How much time is it? And the scripture here pointing to the fact of what we just mentioned concerning hell. Or heaven really being decided in very, very brief lifetimes that we have. That's a major issue. And then it goes on further. It says this, the lost will have to give an account to God. Verse 6, heaven or hell are within just a few moments. Verse 7, emphatic. This is the first thing mentioned in that verse in the Greek. It's emphatic in this fact. It says, the end is at hand. Be sober and be of a sound mind. And then it says in verse 7 and 8, watch to be calm and collected in spirit with a view or vision conducive to the act of praying. Now look at how this is kind of closing in on the verse that the kids are looking at. Look at this list of things. Isn't it interesting that the letters that Peter wrote and the letters that Paul wrote, the first half of the scriptures there is instructive, and then the second half they have lists to be kept. Now those of us who believe in the grace of God and so on, we don't like talking about works. But in every one of Paul's letters, even to Timothy, he gave instruction, he taught. taught on the grace of God. He did all these things, and then he says, no, go and don't let anybody despise your youth. But be an example in word and deed. Dear ones, what's baccalaureate service? But you know what? What's really interesting concerning this is I'm going to stop talking to you guys in just a second, and I'm going to focus on the rest of the world, because this is really their baccalaureate. Because I'm going to plead and cry out to you folks to just say this. These kids are graduating, but they're still kids, and they always will be. If they haven't had an oasis up until now, build one for them. They're going to need things to come back as you would have come up. Because you know what? I think you know this. The world has never been like it is today, before. And they're going to need oases, and these are yours and my little kids. I don't care if they're seniors. They don't like being called the little kids. But they're one thing for sure, they're always going to be our little kids. So have an oasis for them to come back to. Then it goes on further. It says this. Verse 8. Make time for the important. Make time for the important. Love covers a multitude of sins. Here's a little quote from Kenneth Wiest. He said this. Wonder about Christianity on a terror. In other words, those people that whose Christianity is kind of out of control. He goes on and says this. Wonder about Christianity on a terror, whose mind is always crowded with fears and worries. Wonder about that. Who's never at rest in his heart. That man does not have time for prayer. Christianity today. Is it out of control? People who walk around in a dither, activity, dear ones, is not spirituality. People that are like that have very little time for prayer. Moms, pops, students, let's pray for one another. Be still and know what. Think about your day just today. Has it been noisy? I saw some of you coming in at the last minute. Has your day been noisy? God says, be still and know. Learn to slow down. That's becoming an art because we're going through so fast. And then it says this, be friendly, verse 9, to strangers. Be open to physical needs of others. Be hospitable to the Lord's servants. The Lord's servants. Roam over countryside, maybe presenting the gospel. Your own churches, your own officers, your own pastors, and so on. Be hospitable to the Lord's servant, roaming around the country and your churches. Verse 10, there's a gift he mentioned. And this is their verse. It says this. Special enablements, the word gift. Special enablements given to Christians as an aid in the discharge of the special duties to which God has called them. And then it says, and this is what that's talking about, literally, one who governs households. Isn't that interesting? I don't know if the students realize this or not, but you know what that verse is really dealing with? Church officers and heads of families. Church officers and the heads of families. Family, not every word of God is eternal. So whatever is done for him is, did you know that Paul's prayer life, and I'm not being weird, but Paul's prayer life is still being answered today? And did you know that Christ's high priestly prayer in John chapter 17 is still being answered today? Dear ones, let's pray. And after we're gone, the Lord tarries, prayer life will continue to go on being one. Answer. Because anything done for him is eternal. Conclusion. To all of us now, this. Be available to the Lord Jesus Christ from the light of his word. Be available to the Lord Jesus Christ from the light of his word. Be available to the immediate. Don't say, someday I'm going to do this for Christ. But look for gaps right now to be filled. That's His will. Right now. It's unrealistic because you can't be someplace 15 minutes from now, can you? You're here. Remember the illustration I used in class, you guys? If my wife wasn't here right now, who would I love the most? You guys. Because it's not, don't worry, I don't should think it, but it's not weird, okay? Because physically speaking, of course I love my wife. But physically speaking, she's there. She's at work during the week. But she's doing something else. And I love her. You guys know I love her, right? But realistically, my ministry is where? Right here. And then when my wife walks in the room, my face lights up, and then where's my ministry? So that we are never wondering what God's will is. Jeff, hug those little characters right next to you, right there. Didn't have to ask him twice, did I? Ministry right there. Right there. Not wondering, someday I wonder what God's will is for my life. Because God's not the author of confusion. And if it's any more difficult than that, I would miss it. And so ministry is looking us right in the face right now. It's immediate. And it's not someday I wish. It's immediate. It's now. So fill in the gaps. Have you guys had any Sunday school classes that weren't filled by a teacher today? What would have been the will of God? Lead a discussion. Be available. Right there. Be available to make those around. Don't be afraid to borrow brains. I'm not saying cheat. But borrow brains. Don't be too proud. Get help. Be available to make those around you rich. Isn't that what the Lord Jesus Christ did? He lived his life to make others rich. Be available to his grace. Follow by faith. And in him, share what you have. Move and have your being. Thanking the Lord Jesus Christ for the privilege to do so. Here it is again. Be available to his grace. Follow by faith, and in him live, move, and have your being, thanking the Lord Jesus Christ for the privilege to do so, day by day, and moment by moment. Could I just have you students stand up for a second? Stand up for a second. Turn around and pick out the folks that are here with you today. Okay, just pick up, turn around. And those of you folks that are being represented by one of your kids or loved ones or grandchildren or something like that, would you please pick them out in that crowd? Do you see about where they are? And I'd like to just bow for a moment of prayer, and you guys be real selfish for just a second. And you pray for the loved one that's yours up here, and you and Eagle graduates, you pick out whoever your loves are back there, and you pray silently for them concerning the things that we talked about, concerning the things, concerning futures, concerning stuff, and realize that anything done for the Lord Jesus Christ and so on is something that's of an eternal value. And let's just pause just for a word of prayer, and then I'll close. And then those little guys can be seated, and we've got a couple more solos that believe they're going to be singing blessings at this time. Let's just pray.
That's funny looking hat that you're wearing. Which side? go, I'm a redhead. I'm a redhead.
students that will be at Valley Christian United for the next years. We accept this on their behalf. Thank you.
Means that You are now responsible for your own choices. Now, up to this point, graduates, I recognize that you have not had a lot of choices, that you have not been able to choose your parents, you didn't choose your brothers or sisters, you may not have even been able to choose the church that you attended. From now on in life, you are going to have an increasing amount of responsibility for your own choices. Now that may sound wonderful and exciting to you tonight, but I want you to recognize that that also has a great deal of responsibility on it. I want you to recognize that you are also responsible for your own happiness. Up to this point, you may have thought that your parents were the ones to be responsible for your happiness. But after tonight, that is no longer true. Now, I don't suppose that any of you are going to be kicked out of your homes tonight. Some of you are going to go into the job market, and some of you will go into the military. Many of you will go on to a college, higher education. And I suppose that most of you who take those choices still will have good relationships with your parents, and they will still be supporting you in one way or another. And yet at the same time, you do have to recognize that tonight forms a new chapter. And as you turn the page, you need to understand that you are responsible for your own happiness from here on. I want to share with you some of the words of the scriptures that will encourage you and will give you, I think, some helpful hints about how to do that. In the book of Hebrews, it says, "Keep on loving each other as brothers. Not forget to entertain strangers, for by so doing, some people have entertained angels without knowing it. Remember those in prison as if you were their fellow prisoners, those who are mistreated as if you yourselves were suffering." First thing that I want to tell our graduates tonight is that you need to learn to help other people. The way to do that, it says here in Hebrews 13, is to practice loving. The way to do that is to watch God. It is true that God so loved the world that he gave. That's what loving other people is all about. I have, through the years, watched people do bizarre things because they wanted to be loved. I knew a lady one time who literally ran her hand through a plate glass window because she wanted her husband to notice her. I've known of several people in my lives who have gone out and committed heinous crimes and sins because they wanted their mate to notice them and to love them. I have watched as teenagers have attempted suicide and have gotten into drugs and alcohol because they wanted to be loved, because they wanted somebody to notice. I have some hints as to how you might learn to love other people. The first is to learn very early in life to say, "I'm sorry." As you learn to say that when you're in confrontation with other people, you will be amazed at how that will help you to heal a broken relationship. The second suggestion is to learn to forgive other people very quickly. Not because they ask for it, not because they necessarily deserve it, but as you practice the art of forgiving other people quickly, you will discover that that will help you to be a person who loves. Thirdly, I suggest that you allow other people their views. You don't have to believe what they believe. You don't have to work with them on certain levels, or even cooperate with them at certain levels. But learn to be a tolerant and growing person and allow other people their views. The fourth suggestion I have is distinctively Christian, and that is that you learn to suffer loss. That you learn that there are some times when you simply say, "I have been cheated, I have gotten the short end of this deal, but God will make it up. And I'll turn and walk away." That last piece of advice is entirely contrary to everything else you're going to hear in the world system. But perhaps that will help you in some difficult times in your life. I suggest that you learn to be courteous to other people. We all like to hear stories about justice, especially against those who have not been very courteous. Not long ago, as Nancy was going through a grocery checkout line, she only had a bottle of pop. And there was a lady who jumped in right ahead of her who had a whole cartload of groceries. And this lady pushed my wife out of the way and said, "I'm in a hurry," and shoved her basket at the checker. The checker shrugged, not knowing what to do. Nancy stood there rather embarrassed that this person was so rude, and the checker checked out all of this lady's groceries, and the customer continued to harangue and complain and just continued to be the obnoxious person she'd already proven herself to be. When she was finally finished, Nancy stepped up there with her bottle of pop, and the checker said, "It's all been taken care of. I put it on her tab." So discourteous finally get justice. Well, we find that Jesus was a kind person. He was a kind and courteous person, and he taught us to love other people. Someone asked me the other day, what are teenagers made of? So I did a little research about that. And parents, you will love these statistics, because the current statistics show that to raise a teenager from age 13 to age 18 cost approximately $15,000. During that time, that teenager will consume 4,700 bottles of pop. He will gobble 4,200 bowls of cereal. He will devour 2,100 pounds of hamburger. And he will eat 6,100 ice cream cones, 5,400 candy bars, and wear out 78 pair of shoes. That's what a teenager is made of. Well, the Bible tells us how we can learn to be happy people. Graduates, my first suggestion is that you learn to practice helping other people. The second suggestion in this passage in Hebrews 13 says, marriage should be honored by all, and the marriage bed kept pure, for God will judge the adulterer and all the sexually immoral. That may seem like a strange thing to say to high school graduates, but I think that the second suggestion I would like to give you and to the world that you are going is that you keep sexually pure. It says here in the Bible that marriage is to be honored. Through the years, as I have done a lot of marriage counseling, I have discovered that almost always when people are having problems in their marriage, it is because they have disobeyed some clear teaching of the Bible, that they have transgressed the principles that God has put for us here in the Scriptures. I suppose that most of you in the coming years will find just that right person and you will be married. And when you begin to think about marriage, I challenge you to think deeply and spiritually about that choice, and that you look and you wait and you think and you pray and you get the counsel that you will need before that choice is made. Now, in marriage, like in every other part of life, I find that there are a lot of misunderstandings, and parents and teenagers know that in our homes, often we misunderstand one another. Not long ago, I came home after a hard day, parked in the garage, and came into the house through the kitchen. As I came in, one of my teenagers was there in the kitchen with a radio blaring. And I tried to gain my composure over that. And I said, dear, would you mind turning down that racket? And she reached over and turned off the dishwasher. We know that there are those kinds of misunderstandings in our home. And there are those kinds of misunderstandings in marriage, too. Reminds me of the story of the fellow who was walking through the cemetery, and he saw a man kneeling over one of the graves, and he was pounding on the grave, and he was moaning, "Oh, why did you die?" The man went to the mourner and said, "Is this your wife who's died, sir?" He said, "No, it's not my wife." Why did you die? Why did you die? He said, "Must be one of your parents or a close relative." He said, "No, it's no relative. Pounding the grave. Why did you die? Why did you die?" He said, "Well, it certainly must have been a good friend." He said, "No, I never knew this person." "Why? Why did you die?" He said, well, whose grave is this?" He said, "It's my wife's first husband." "Why? Why did you die?" Well, there are those misunderstandings and problems in marriage. But I hope that those kinds of misunderstandings and those kinds of jokes won't frighten you from marriage. And I hope also that you will obey what the Scriptures say here. The Scriptures very clearly teach us here in Hebrews chapter 13 that sex outside of marriage is wrong. Oh, I know that that's very common today. I'm quite aware of that, to be sure. I see it all the time with people coming in, broken hearts and broken families. And I want you to remember that if 50 million people say a stupid thing, it's still a stupid thing. And if 50 million people say that sex outside of marriage is okay, it's still a stupid thing. And it is still wrong in the eyes of God. I've come to believe that sex outside of marriage has a lot of problems associated with it. The biggest problem, frankly, is not venereal disease. The biggest problem is not that you might get AIDS and die. I do not even believe that the biggest problem will be all of that guilt that you will have if you engage in sex outside of marriage. I believe, quite frankly, that the biggest problem is that God says that is wrong. Here in this passage in Hebrews 13, as it says elsewhere in the Bible, God will judge that sin. And I would like to see you avoid that as you continue on your walk in life and your walk with God. There are a lot of excuses for young people today to be involved in sex outside of marriage. There are those who say, well, we are truly in love, and we are truly committed to one another. There are those who say, well, we're going to get married anyway. But all of those excuses crumble before the throne of God. And all of those excuses mean nothing, because it is still wrong, and God will still judge it. Marriage is to be reserved, or sex is to be reserved for marriage. The third suggestion I have for you is here in this passage also. It says, keep your lives free from the love of money, and be content with what you have, because God has said, never will I leave you, and never will I forsake you. I think that it is important for you to hear tonight that you should learn to be content in life. Now, that's very difficult in today's world. You will leave your home, you graduate tonight, going into a world that has high expectations of you. The whole world system is geared so that you might make more money. If you go on to higher education, the expectation is you are doing that so you can get a better job, so you can make more money. I see young people today leaving their homes, and they expect to have immediately in their own home or apartment exactly what their parents have, and it took them 25 or 30 years to get there. So you leave high school today with a lot of expectations and a lot of pressure to do and to gain and to have a higher standard of living. But I have seen through the years that those who make money their goal are never satisfied. Bertrand Russell said in his preoccupation with possessions more than any other thing in life that causes people not to be able to live freely and nobly. I find that the people who think that money is that which will give them freedom are badly disillusioned, because it says here in the Bible that money does not give you freedom, but it actually enslaves. Money is that kind of product that you can never get enough of if that is your goal. Certainly, I do not think that money and success is evil. I believe that there are some good things that can come from it. But I have a couple of suggestions that might help you to be content with what you have. The first is, do not make money your goal. The second is to learn to live within your income. I hope you heard that, because it's a very simple principle that most people know and believe and do not practice. Learn to live within your income. The third suggestion is what it says here in Hebrews 13. Learn to be content with what you have. During these past few moments, in the United States, there have been 29 teenagers who have attempted suicide. There have been 23 teenage girls who've had abortions. There have been 685 teenagers who have become regular drug users. That happens every 30 minutes in the United States. And in the United States, there are many unhappy people. And I trust that as you leave high school and go on to whatever your plans will call for you to do, you will be a happy and a contented person. You can do that if you'll simply follow a few principles in the scriptures. And here they are. Practice helping other people. Keep sexually pure. And learn to be content.
privilege of presenting the awards to the students tonight. Before I do that, I would like to point out that the flowers that are here in front of us are a gift from Dr. Thorpe, who is going to be here next week as our new administrator and class. I want you to know that he's thinking of you. So we appreciate the fact that his heart is here. We're looking forward to having you here leading us. The awards that we have tonight, some of the students have already received the awards. They know what they are. And I'm just going to recognize them and ask them to stand to let you know what awards they have received. Others are to be given out tonight. So if it's just the way it worked out tonight. First of all, I would like to recognize those students who have received from Mesa Community College the President's Scholarship, which is a two-year scholarship which covers tuition and books. We have four such scholars. Rhett Beyer. Outstanding both in music, choral music, and in instrumental music, and that is Sarah Watts.
Graduates of Valley Christian High School sitting before you this evening are all individual success stories. Each one has shown excellence in one or more endeavors, even though that excellence may not be generally known. You have before you an assortment of talent, athletes both male and female, who have given outstanding performances in basketball, football, softball, cross country and track, leaders in student government, musicians, vocalists, and dramatists. Students have shown exceptional ability in the field of missions by working on the chapel committee. They are the quiet ones who are ready and willing to give of their time and energy when called upon, and the humorists who made us laugh when we were feeling down, who have been a support group for each other, and the challenges we have met have been with the knowledge that parents, teachers, and staff would be within easy reach. Now, however, we will face our greatest challenge, to find our place in a world that is not always kind. But the foundation for success has already been laid. All we need is to continue the construction. To help assure our success, there are several things we can do. The first is to reach a little higher, for how many dreams have not been realized because that extra effort was not put forth. The second is to throw the word can't out of our vocabulary because it can end a dream before it's ever begun. Thirdly, when failure comes our way, we need to accept that as a normal part of living and then pick ourselves up, continue the struggle, and never accept defeat. Fourthly, to continue our education, whether full-time, part-time, after work, or at night, anytime. Without education, we close a window that looks out onto the fifthly, we need to keep God and have faith in Him, because with Him anything is possible. Matthew 17:20 reads, "If ye have faith as a mustard seed, ye shall say unto this mountain, remove hence to yonder place, and it shall remove, and nothing shall be impossible to you." And lastly, I would like to see friendships that began here 4 years ago continue. Turn to that one who has been closest to you and say, "If you ever need someone to talk to, call me and I'll be there." Going separate ways after graduation doesn't mean to me total separation. The decisions we make now will determine the direction of the rest of our lives, and with these versatile graduates, the choices of career will be varied. And it's heartening to realize that each one of us has the capacity to make a difference in our world by turning our backs on indifference, by daring to find personal fulfillment in helping those who are hurting physically, mentally, or spiritually. We are the untapped resource of the future. To reach our full potential, we should be challenged to further enhance our talents through higher education, to continue to live by our values, and to live less for the monetary rewards of this world and more for the spiritual rewards God gives us. the decisions to seek a college level education, our chances to succeed in a highly specialized world will be greatly increased. Studies will be intensified and will be endeavoring to absorb the knowledge of one or perhaps two careers. With the rapid advance of technology, the gathering and sharing of information will seem to be enormous, and it should be obvious to us that our education will not end with a degree. It will necessarily continue throughout our lives. So let's grasp the opportunities we have to enrich our minds through learning and pledge to inform and teach others whenever we can. And while we are pursuing a more formal education, let us not forget the very practical education we receive for our lifetime experiences, because learning from life seems to be the most difficult test of all. How many times have we heard someone say, "I only knew then what I know now"? However, individual decisions can only be based on the current level of knowledge, and we, as new graduates, will make our share of wrong choices. Learning from our mistakes will be our real test of maturity. The values each of us carries today have been carefully nurtured the past 18 years by our parents, our church, and the Word of God. And in the complex world we will be becoming a part of, these values will be put to the test every day. Let's just remember that when the word of man falters, his word will stand the test of time. Accept the challenge of being a Christian, because when guided as a teacher, you will never fail. As we, on the stage before you, spend our last few minutes as students in Nevada Christian High School, I would hope that the word graduation does not have a ring of finality to it. Quite the opposite, it should actually be regarded as just another step onward. For the past 12 years, we have completed a summer required course of study, but now have an ever widening, varied source of knowledge to choose from. An adventure without end if we had only taken advantage of it. We must not expect it to come to us, but we must go after it and strive for our goals. It will not always be easy to attain. There's going to be a lot of work and self-sacrifice. And we shouldn't just quit and settle for second best when the going gets tough. We must push and work for what we really want to be, even if most people say that's beyond our reach. So let's not limit ourselves to what may be expected of us, but strive for the unexpected. Graduates of 1989 presented here are to be congratulated on a job well done. Each has strived for his or her own personal best. The loving concern of parents and teachers has shaped exuberant youth into young adults who will lead Valley Christian armed with tools of success. May each of us put forth a hearty effort to use those tools with which we will build our tomorrow. Tucker forgot to mention that not only the other things about teenagers, but they also went through about 500 pieces of chalk during their 4 years here, 750 pieces of gum that we picked up, and 1,200 thirst busters that are around the campus. The theme that we've gone by at Valley Christian High School for the years that we've been here is just because you come from a small school does not mean you cannot be a big person. And these seniors here tonight have all through the years done many things to make them a big person as far as academically, on the athletically and spiritually. And we, the faculty, and I will miss these seniors. I've known most of them for 4 years, and I could turn around and maybe tell a story or two about each one that I know. Many of these students that I've asked to do many things for me over the 4 years, and each time they've been willing and more than able to do that. We're going to miss these seniors, as we do all our graduating classes, but this class will be remembered as the largest class, and it is now my pleasure to read the list of those graduating seniors. Trenton, Danford, Ainsworth. Jeffrey Allen Kuzmich.
Joel David Van Zandt.
It's with pleasure that I present to you the class of 1989.
Praise and all the glory, and we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.